Okay, we are back. Let us take another look at this good old rectangle. It's a 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, 20, 21, right? Right? Wait. Well, 7 wide and, yeah, 27. So it's actually 20. Does that make sense? Yeah, just cut away 2 at once, left for 2, so it should be... should be even width. Yeah, even width, that makes sense. Yeah, so even width by 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 13 tall. And that makes sense with the other observations that we've seen earlier, wherein there was that extra bit here, where if you cut away, get out of the way, man. It's gonna do some counting. Intense counting. Right, where you just take away 2 at once and you wind up with an odd number left instead of an even number left. Right, makes sense. So the other thing that I was just thinking about in between episodes is that, of course I did start out with, this kind of a mimic placement where you just have him on the same column, and I was running into so many problems with, the mimic just getting trapped by tar babies that were, you know, clogging up the way and being in the way of the mimic trying to get to its next spot. Of course, placing the mimic on the same column as you is for simple-minded individuals, or rather, naive individuals, perhaps. So why don't we do something like this instead? Well, I'll tell you why not. It's because, well, that's clearly not going anywhere good now, is it? That's definitely wrong. Putting the mimic on top like that isn't gonna help matters, especially since, as I've shown in the prior episode, pretty sure you want Beethro on the top row here, and the mimic on some area below it, just so that Beethro can go along the top. Tar protects him from the giant horde of tar babies, and he can just crawl west, keep going west, sword southeast, turn south, hit that orb. Which, it's a little bit rude that the orb is actually, like, here, instead of, like, somewhere you just naturally hit while you're facing southeast, so the fact that it's in the corner here like this means that it's another one of those one or two move timer adjustments here. I mean, we certainly had plenty of that already, like, you can do that with the fuse, but doing that with the orb itself is also a little bit rude. The fact that it constrains your final sword orientation. Pressure plates is a good way of solving that, because it doesn't matter what way your sword is facing, it just matters how far Beethro is away from that. But that is technology that we will not have until later. Dropping a trapdoor, however, is, dropping a trapdoor is an alternative that could potentially work with some widgets, but, or waking up an evil eye before, like, the door closes that would trap it in. But those are all solutions that are, not employed here. That's not what we're being used here. It's useless to speculate about what the room might have been. Targate Stronghold is what this room might have been, but this room is what it is. Is what it is. So, how about we put the mimic over here? That could potentially help. It won't necessarily help, but it could potentially help. Actually, here's the advantage of this, is, I can turn my sword northwest like this, and, does that actually help much? Not really. It means I can cut that without cutting the bottom, I guess. But it still means that, the mimic has to cut his bit down here, and we're misaligned, too. Well, that's not so bad, because that's still correct, what I'm doing here. The fact that I had to cut that last west bit, though, is bad. So, alright, fine. Then that means that I have to cut... see, now things get complicated, though. Because I'm not killing the tar babies at the same time. That's gonna have to be good enough. We're just doing a little bit of measurement here. Just for the sake of curiosity, let's see where this gets us. So now, the advantage of doing this is that now that the mimic is one column to the north of us, now he can make north moves like this, no problem. And, so now it gets into the correct row here. The disadvantage of that is it got a little misaligned, so I have to kind of duck out east a little bit here and waste a little bit of time doing that. And yeah, as I thought, this is actually wasting us time, because we're even further behind now than we were the other time. I guess I'll save this for posterity anyway. But let's actually count then. One, two, or wait. So that would not save it, so we have to hit it on this turn, so. 1, 2, 4, 6, 8, 12, no, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, 20, 21? Oh, sure, we'll call it 21. 21 moves short, but neat. Alright. We got plenty of reference material if we want it, but we must forge ever onwards and get something, you know, that actually works better. Another alternative that I hadn't really considered was doing something like this. That's certainly an option. That means I can do these early, but it means that my parity is wrong for, doing this. I guess I can do this. That's not great, but... Oh, well, that's an issue. Okay. Well, what if we don't do that yet, then? But yeah, that has to be our final approach. Do this, but I don't think that's gonna go anywhere, is it? I guess we can do like this slide. Mimic can start cutting away its bits here. Unfortunately, we have these two tar babies that came out the west side that are not my friends, let's say. Alright, that's gonna have to be good enough. So then, Mimic cuts these on this way. Beethro cuts these on that way, and that is actually the closest we've been yet. So we'd have to hit the orb on this turn. So if we hit the orb now, we would have been perfect. So, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 moves. Short. So that's interesting. That was a different way of doing it that certainly wasted less time, but still wasted some time because, let's review that again. Yeah, what happened here? So this part doesn't waste much time, but we do have to start at the upper end, but that's sort of necessary due to the fact that we need to be up here and then over here. And this is what happened second. That kind of makes sense, because the tar babies have to be spawned first. I'd prefer it if it were the other way around, but I guess that's not 100% always going to be possible. So then we go here. We need to do a little bit of finagling here that wastes some time to take care of the babies that came around the west side. And get the mimic in position, but it's not awful. It's sort of the right idea, but I think we can certainly... I think I already have another idea of what I'm going to do next. Okay. So what if instead we don't do the bottommost part first, but instead we do something like this? Well, we don't want to do something like that then. What if we just spawn the tar babies immediately, I guess? Then we do this. Those will come through the middle. It's probably not what I want. So now we have to waste time getting them to drain again. But we could potentially combine this with the other strategy, though. But we're getting a lot of babies on the west side now. Yeah, that's no good. Especially the fact that there's, like, this one down here. This one is so far away... Oh, wait, not this one, but this one. Yeah, this one is so far away from Beethro, and yet Beethro still needs to kill it. That is not good for saving time. But Just for the sake of argument, let's see what happens, anyway. We need to keep going as far as possible. Yeah, like, that's just killer. And also, we can't let that happen. Creep down here and cut these. Okay. Okay, so that's not bad. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5... Wait, this was... Yeah, we have to already do it on this turn. But this is correct, so... This is, like, on time. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 moves, but different. And then what was the other one? Also 7. Okay. Alright, so what if we combine that with the other thought, which was putting us, I guess over here, then? That causes one baby to come in behind me. Okay. This would work if I could somehow face east in a smooth fashion, but I can't, or can I? Alright, if I didn't have that tar baby there, then maybe this would be competitive, but this is starting to seem a little bit messier than is really necessary. Yeah, this is what happens when you just spawn babies early, is they start messing everything up with their, you know, tendency to go outside the outside of the blob and change rows, and... Yeah, it's just messy. If I can avoid it, I will, but... If, on the other hand, if it's necessary, then I will have to do it, one way or another. Okay, what if I offset the other way? Potentially helpful. Probably not like that, though. That's interesting, though. Could do something like this. Probably not the best for actually getting... Yeah, because we don't want BBs close to Beethro, and he still has to cut that, though. In the slightest. No, let's maybe not do that one. Yeah, because this corresponds to that right now. At least that's the correspondence I'm set up with, and that's not really what I want. So you don't want Beethro to be making those kinds of cuts that make giant amounts of babies unless there's a correspondence. If I've already made that cut, then I can follow in here, but then the mimic is on the wrong row to start cutting that, though. And plus I'd emerge out this side, and I have tar babies out the west that are waiting for me, so I wouldn't be able to go east and then west again. Yeah, so that doesn't quite seem right. Interesting, but wrong. A lot of ways you can describe solutions to rooms like this one. But yeah, it really surprises me that he's going in with a room that's this complicated right off the bat. Did we have a room... I'm trying to remember, like, the chronology now. Did we have Odd Jobs published at this point? Or did this come first? I don't know. Because that had a similar, like, ice-chopping block room, but you only had Beethro involved. I believe you did not have a Mimic. But this clearly shows that Reb was playing around with this Beethro plus Mimic's clear tar as fast as possible. Don't worry about the babies, just clear tar as fast as possible. this kind of room fairly early on, and he clearly liked it enough to want to build an entire hold level around it. Because it is a neat idea, at least when it's, when it shows off a reliably repeatable strategy, that is. Yeah, see, I don't know, though. Yeah, so there's just, like, a lot of different variations you can try, though, is the thing. Yeah, so if I do that, that winds up with the even bit on the top. If I do this, that causes that. If I go up one more, that causes this weird thing to happen, which is almost certainly not what I want. Right, because then that puts that on the edge, so I'd have to adjust that once. Which would be possible if the mimic was one square to the east, so I guess we'll try that just for the sake of argument, just for the sake of getting something on video. Like, I do not like having three here, five here, and three here. That just doesn't seem right to me. But, you know. Okay, so now I've got this in alignment. I do not have any tar babies behind me, which is interesting. Now we're coming around this side. I mean, okay. This still seems so wrong, though. Like intellectually terrifying. And, you know, this is gonna fail because, no, it's not, because I... Wait, what happened? Aren't I supposed to wind up with a too wide blob here? I'll have to double check later, but whatever, let's just go with it. There is no clean way of dealing with these tar babies. They have been created in such a way that, that it's not good. So the correct way of doing that would be to, like, face west and have the mimic behind me so that the mimic plows through this onto the west, but Beethro gets over here with the sword west, which I think would result in, yeah, one of these tar babies catching up with him. No good. Although facing west would mean I'd hit the orb one turn earlier, which is interesting, but I don't think relevant for this room. I think dragging the sword southeast along the top edge is the correct strategy. Going southeast, facing southeast, dragging west all the way over here. Backswiping this orb. Okay, well that's, I found one more thing that doesn't work. See, this is what's really bugging me a little bit, is the fact that you can do this on this side, but not on that side. I keep getting attracted to the fact that you can do that, but I'm pretty sure it's wrong, because it's just putting the mimic in the wrong place. I'm pretty sure you need the mimic south of you in order for this strategy to work. Just because it's theoretically possible, actually, now that I think about it, because, like, if the mimic is right here, if I, like, I don't know, do this, just for point of reference, if I come up this side and I'm facing southeast, then that does mean that because this black door will be open, I can actually get Beethro to go here, and then here. And then, like, because this diagonal is open, because of this black door that I was worried about earlier, now it actually works to Beethro's benefit, because he would actually be able to cut this corner right here and go up and in here, and then... So that means that it is theoretically possible that I could do this room with the mimic above me. That seems iffy. But I'll at least give that a little bit more investigation. That means that... What does that mean? That would mean that the mimic would be dragging... Or does it? What are my options then? Make something that looked like that. But we're still going to wind up with that, like, extra 2x2 strip of tar, this thing here. That thing has to be dealt with by the mimic. And I would certainly prefer to not have this giant horde of tar babies between Beethro and where he needs to go. That's certainly not going to help. the entire point of putting the mimic below me was so that this set of tar babies that came from this extra bit here would be below Beethro and, like, out of the way instead of in the way. So I think even just based upon that, I think that seems like a good reason to just throw out that entire class of solution. Because I don't see any way around that. If you do it differently, if you do it like this, then that constrains, well, yeah, see, now we're making things awkward over here. Yeah, because you certainly can't cut that. That's a no-go. Alright. So what else does that mean I can do? Because I can do other things. What if... Yeah, so putting it on this row seems to only have those two strategies. This one that I just did, which seems unhelpful. That one, which is seems intellectually horrifying, just like the other one. And this one, where I had some minor success in generating the tar baby strip down here, but at least you get two nice rows of fives here, so you can cut out once, turn around and cut the bottom again, go up this side, and then cut that. Or cut that, go over here and back. Which is equal in number of round trips, but it's not pleasant dealing with this mess on the west side. There has to be a better way. So if I put it on this row, I can't put the mimic over here. This has actually been a common feature on a lot of puzzles, is just the addition of these, like, funneling walls to kind of restrict where you can actually put the mimic relative to Beethro that will actually help you, which is good-ish for ruling out, I guess that's a guarantee from the architect that none of those positions will work. And so, it's something that I should be thankful for, but I'm not, which is a strange feeling that I don't really have all that often. Because, like, that's a kind of a feeling that, like, I'd like to instill in others, but I don't really do it all that often. I don't know, it's strange, but I'm gonna have to set that one aside. It's not really helpful for the mission. But it is good to talk about these things every now and then. Let's see, so... If I cut these immediately. What that would mean is I'd have to get Beethro up here, and somehow not have any tar babies following. Which I could maybe see that working if I do this just right, so I guess I'll try it. Let's be deliberately a little inefficient for the first run, I guess. This could maybe work. Maybe. If I don't have that one tar baby on me, of course. Not much to be done about that. Okay, we'll call that good enough. Just for measurement purposes, because I'm just trying to benchmark this, remember. Of course, now we have all these tar babies clogging up the way, and there's not really any way, practical way of dealing with those. Yeah, not helpful there. I mean, I guess I could just kill them, but that seems way too slow. Especially if I'm killing them once every two turns. That's just, you know, that's not helping anybody out. Yeah, so that's just way too slow, if I do that, yeah. Because I had to do that awkward thing to deal with some tar babies over here, and dealing with this was ultra awkward. That's way too slow to be efficient. So that's, we'll throw that part out, but let's see, so I did... Put the other one down here. Right, so this is what... So I guess the attractive feature of this is that it kind of puts off, like, the making of this row of tar babies a little bit into this part. Like, I do it in the middle instead of at the beginning of the room. I do that when I'm almost but not quite done. The last thing I do is I get rid of this tar strip and this tar strip. Which, come to think of it, I could do facing northeast, couldn't I? Well, no, that wouldn't really help. Or would it? No, it wouldn't help because then I'd have like a tar baby like right here when Beethro is facing northeast. So unless I say that, but it would help. It would just barely work if no, I don't think it would actually work. Because that would, unless I got rid of this corner here. If I don't get rid of this corner here, then Beethro will be facing northeast. Then the mimic will take care of this, but there will be that one last tar baby that he'll have to, like, face north for to stay on this diagonal. It just won't work. Because he'll have to waste a turn in place instead of starting his, like, northward climb to get away from the tar babies that are trying to mob him. Like, especially the ones that just, like, this one that just came from this section. But if he's already killed the ones that were to the north of him because he already got this little notch of tar right here, this one. Like, if this is the one. Then if he is facing northeast and kills this and drags his way over there, then he doesn't have to worry about that one. He can just go straight to the diagonal and go straight. Then his sword is facing way the wrong way and he has to turn three times in order to hit that orb, but... details. So that could theoretically work. This formation could work, and Beethro could be facing northeast for this last bit. If he turns around somehow, which is not really possible to do in this one-wide tar corridor. But that does actually open up possibilities for the other one class of solutions I was thinking about, which was this one. Because that means that maybe I could deal with cut away this somehow. Well, that seems unlikely. Cutting this and then also facing, like, northeast. No, that's not really gonna work. Yeah, this is just the same thing as the other one. I guess the advantage of this is I've already dealt with the bottom one on the way there, so I don't have to worry about this part anymore. But it's still too slow. So I'd have to hit it now with this move. So that's 0, 2, 4, 6, 8, 9. Yeah, so that's 9 moves too short. Huh. Well, there's just a small insight with, I think it might actually just be dealing with the tar babies that's, losing me here. So I think, since I'm, getting a little bit low on time, I think what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna leave this on the back burner. This is the kind of room that you just have to really, really think about a lot of different alternative approaches for. Might be a little less LP, genic than the, other ones, but, let's, for the sake of not, hammering my head against, one room all this time, I'm gonna do the secret room. But I'm not going to do this one. This one I need to do as part of a chain, I think, because I'm getting the distinct impression I need to solve this in the same save file. Clear that green door. Also solve this one to open this green door. So I think I need to solve both of these in the same trip. So we'll leave that one alone. I think what I will do instead is I will take a look at this tunnel secret room. This is just a regular old secret room that is not connected to any other rooms. This is just optional. I can do it anytime, so I will just try it now. And that'll count towards mastery at the end. Okay, well, it would, well, everything's brained. So it would appear that I want you to come in a certain direction. West is not that direction. I have a feeling the Wraith Rings are actually relevant, but I'm not sure how yet. Okay. But let's just do our naive first approach. What goes wrong? Well, those Wraithrings actually physically body block me. That's a new one. Haven't had a problem with that in a long time. We are just trying to kill the Tar Mothers as fast as possible, not necessarily to destroy all the Tar. Although this is a series of one-way passages, so I actually did need to kill that set of Evil Eyes. Okay. Let's not get too far ahead of ourselves. It's important to spot these things early. Alright, that's technically a waste of a turn. Can we do this a little bit better then? This was the most promising set of moves. Okay, that time the Wraithwing is still in the way. Wraithwing, please be less in the way. I don't want to kill them because they're technically not as harmful as they could be, but they're still being in the... if I could maybe get away without killing them, because that would be a turn in which I'm not, like, moving towards something important, or... I guess that's good. Alright, that means I killed that without wasting too much time. Except I totally did waste time. Alright, what even happened here? Oh, it's because I wasted time, like, I didn't waste time, but I had to kill those two Evil Eyes. That's why I was able to get here two turns faster the other time, is because I just saved time by not completing my mission, is what I didn't do. Yeah, but my timing is just not very good for this part. Okay, so those two Wraithwings are following me. I'll be able to kill them later. Or they'll be able to kill me later. Same thing, really. If I stand up there, they can't, because I'm further away from the southern ones. And again, I arrive here at turn 3, and I need to arrive here at turn 4 in order to actually make meaningful progress, so... I just have to wait. At this point... At this point, I need to already have those two Wraithrings dead. Okay, so I do need to kill them at some point, then. But how does that affect my timing for the other parts, then? Because I could... There were several parts in which I could have killed them. Like, I don't know, back here. Like, that's one per turn. But that means I might be less efficient for the next part. I don't know, that didn't seem to affect matters too much, but I'm still a little bit iffy. It means that mostly those spawns that I was three turns short for, again, are just kind of now happening naturally on their own anyway. So I guess it's not awful. I'm mostly on track, though, I think. Not, like, definitely not, like, I'm not feeling, like, way far out ahead, but... Alright, that's a little bit wasteful. Let's try that part again. Yeah, I want to have a steady, uninterrupted stream of Evil Eyes coming to me so I can just kill them without wasting time, almost. That'll do. I don't know which of these is better, but I don't know, I'll just go with this, I guess. I don't want too much of this to actually spawn, though. Because that'll just create extra problems for me. Although, again, I need to remind myself, you don't need to actually destroy all the tar, just the tar mothers. And, like, just enough of the tar so that, like... Oh, man, this is rough, though. I think I'm already losing time. I don't have to worry about... Okay, so that confirms it. Like, if I have to kill, like, this set of tar mothers and this set of tar mothers in the same spawn, then I'm definitely, like, overdoing it, thinking about, like, any tar spawning here, because, like, this is the last tar spawn, is what that is. Which seems to imply I actually don't want that Wraithwing right there, because if I can get tar in there, then I can just kind of cut around that 2x2 bit there and not worry about it. Go over here, kill these in the corner. Or maybe just don't even cut that. So maybe just go over here after all then. Alright. How's that then? Let's see. Two moves too short. That's not too bad. Now we're actually getting somewhere. So, like, don't worry about any of that. Just leave that for later. Was there any tar in this section? I don't think so. I could maybe have ignored some tar up here. How would that have worked? Not without some really specific manipulations, I think. Yeah, so we're just gonna wind up killing all that tar anyway. So we just have to do this part a little bit faster, do the bottom part a little bit faster, and we'll get that, I don't think we want that Wraithwing all the way in the corner, but we'll see how that affects us. I don't like the fact that I had to kill an extra tar baby there, and yeah, now I'm way behind. Yeah, so I need to, like, yeah, because that's the thing, it's like, in situations like that, you don't want to be standing there just swinging your sword, killing all these evil eyes. The reason the other one went so well last time, I should have saved that demo of when I was here with two moves to spare, that would have been really helpful for reference purposes. And of course it figures the one time I do that, I don't. But what I can do instead... So I can still recover that sequence of moves, I can still restore here. Except that this is what happened on the bad one, so no, I actually can't. It was a nice try, though. If that had been the only time I'd stepped on that checkpoint, then I would have been able to do that, but I overrid it. Oh well, that's fine. Let us assume that the fighting up to this point was fine. I could perhaps wiggle a little bit to change, how the Wraithwings present themselves. I think I don't want to wake those up quite yet. So maybe I do it at this timing instead. Might be a little bit better. Yeah, because now I can come here with sword facing southeast, and that seems to have been better for me. Waking up all that stuff a little bit early, but I think the best of all that was when I was able to sneak around the top. Like this. Okay, so this is 5 moves too short, and I guess I'll save this one. But just for... let's review what happened. Parts that were annoying, that stand out as being annoying. These tar babies here, would be obviously a lot better if they weren't here. That would involve changing how I approached this part in the east here, the very first part. Which would involve changing the position of this Wraithwing a little bit. There's a lot of room for improvement over here based upon foibles like what movement order and position these wraithings are in, and the timing for when I wake up these very first evil eyes here when I step onto this row. Other than that, this one seems to mostly be pretty static, based upon, like, these two things are just based upon your performance in this part, but there's not really much you can do other than improvise. They're pretty straightforward, I think. Alright, so let's see if we can redo the first part then. Because there is a single Wraithwing here, and I would like it to be up in this corner rather than, with the Tar Baby in here. It seems like we're gonna get a Tar Baby. Well, if I can get the Wraithwing in here, that would actually be nice, but I don't know how you would do that. Yeah, that seems unlikely, so let's just aim for this part. I don't know how it wound up on this little segment here, but something must have happened. But yeah, these parts may not be as separate as I may have thought. Yeah, I must have been down on this row at spawn time for some reason. Okay, so that gets rid of that Tar Baby. Probably makes this part a little bit smoother. There will be a Tar Baby here, but I can probably kill that in line with everything else. That's fine. I don't like that Wraithwing wound up in the corner, though, so we'll redo things so that it winds up over there instead. I can kill it naturally like that. Okay, still get there in time to do that part the same way that I've been doing it all these other times. Still have to wait here for that part. And the moves I make in this part affect the way that these Wraithwings shake out, but I'm mostly not trying to worry too much about that. Here's another one of those arrive here in 3 points. Which I guess if, that's possible to design for a little bit, maybe. Don't like that. That's no good. Need to go a little bit faster through that part. So how can I do that better? This, I guess? It'd be ideal if I could do that, though. That gets there in time. After that, I'm more flexible. Now you're starting to get into, like, interactions of three-brained Wraithwings territory, so it gets just chaotic as all get out. Not really in the way I like. I don't mind manipulating, like, groups of Wraithwings too much as long as you have enough room to do it in, but I think in scenarios like this where every move is important, I'd rather not be getting hung up on the specific moves that Wraithwings taking being so important. But on the plus side, I guess at least I get this part done. But I think I'm a little bit behind schedule. So that is 3 moves short. Okay. Starting to get somewhere, though. And at least we have a nice little cathartic bonus at the end when I finally do get this. Okay. So, I think having the Wraithwing in this position was a net positive, because I still had to waste time killing that extra Tar Baby anyway, and this, like, eye right in the corner here is a little bit needy. I think it is better to come in on this side. You have to waste a little bit of time killing this single Tar Baby over here. What does this look like at the start? Okay, so that tar is always there. Okay, good to know. I don't think I had any way of influencing it in the first spawn cycle anyway, but still good to know. So the only things I have to play with is this particular Wraithing's position. And I don't think there's any way of putting it in here. That would actually be pretty good, but I don't think there's any way of doing that. Because Beethro is just too far over on the right here. And there's no way of forcing it southwest before the first spawn. So really, the furthest south Beethro can go is here. So this is really just amounts to a constraint saying, don't have Beethro here on turn 30 and nothing else. After that, it's just kind of there, I guess. Oh boy. Alright, let's try that again. It's a little bit iffy that I have to backtrack here at this point, but it also means that I don't die at the start, so that's good. Yeah, because otherwise I wind up with my sword facing southwest. That was one fewer advance into the room, but I'm facing the wrong way to kill that Wraithwing. But I only have to spend one turn doing it instead of two, so maybe that's still better. It means that just saving that one move does actually mean that I'm saving, like, three moves, because instead of being just short to actually kill that and having to wait here, I'd have to wait three turns here if I'm one turn too short. But getting here with four turns remaining means that I can cut all that and then cut this, which saves me three turns. So it's like saving one turn saves me three turns. Ah, man. These things get complicated. DROD is a tough game, you know? I don't really say that often enough, but it deserves to be said more than just a couple times. So that actually puts me a little bit ahead of the game over here. Okay, that Wraithwing is in the correct position. And I wind up killing that one almost for free. Not quite, but almost. And I get to this spot in time. So I'm still, like, maintaining those three saved moves. So this is good. Don't really get here in time, though. Okay, so can I save a move here, then? This is, like, the kind of thing that I'm thinking about now, is, like, do I need to beat all of those checkpoints, though? Do I need to be that one tile closer on all of these relevant spawn cycles? Maybe I do. Maybe I do in order to be able to make the overall timer. Maybe that's what this room is secretly about. There's a lot of red herrings here, muddling the message, if that's the actual message. I think if I were building a room about this, I'd probably try and make it as simple as possible, meeting these kinds of checkpoints. But it's interesting the thought that maybe this room has a design principle underlying it, as opposed to just being a tactical room. We may be getting a glimpse into the mind of Reb, even if he isn't actually commenting on the videos yet. I mean, he's a busy guy. I'm sure he's doing something. But that's alright. We're gonna get the architect's commentary straight from the work itself, using, all the literary theories that are available to us. You know, maybe this hold will speak for itself. Okay, so that kind of makes me still feel like I'm behind, though, the fact that I repeated this situation. Means I think I'm gonna be like four moves short. Three moves short. Okay. Well, I'll still save a move demo anyway. Our checkpoints. Cause like, yeah, if I saved three moves due to somehow saving time in one of these segments, or you know, maybe this one. This one is still not sure. I'm kind of improvising my way through this evil eye segment over here. Trying to figure out some way to get through it evenly. It'd be nice if, like, both of these were four checkpoints just because I'm spending so much time going up through the north row instead of waking these ones up too early. So it would be nice if, like, both of these were checkpoints so that you couldn't miss the checkpoint. You know, all these other ones are pretty easy to hit, especially, like, the ones that are in the middle of the corridor. Anyway, but that's what I'm thinking, is like, if I save time on one of these, perhaps that accelerates me by three moves, I can keep that three move acceleration through this part, and then that, you know, then presto, change-o, we are three moves ahead here, and we are done. I don't know, lots to think about. I think I'm just gonna leave it at that, though. There's, a lot that goes into efficiency. You have to think about everything.